Hello and welcome to today's Fireside Chat on a licensing introduction for Power Automate. My name is Carlo Doherty. I'm Principal Licensing Consultant here at Version 1. And on today's Fireside Chat, I'm joined by my colleague, Niamh. How are you doing today, Niamh?
I'm good, thanks, Carl. How are you?
Good, not too bad. So I think this is the third or fourth installment in our Power Platform series of licensing Fireside Chats. Power Automate, we're going to have a quick licensing overview or introduction to licensing for Power Automate. So for those who don't know, Power Automate is yet another SaaS platform or offering from Microsoft. It sits within the Power Platform family of products, which includes Power BI, Power Apps, to name a few. What is Power Automate? I suppose if it's to sum it up in one sentence, customers would use it to increase efficiency, reduce costs through the introduction of repetitive tasks and business processes. It is an interesting one when it comes to licensing, a bit like Power Apps, I kind of feel as well, is that when you say Power Automate to a customer, sometimes there's a glazed over look of confusion as to, you know, do we have the licenses already, or we think we have the licenses for it already, or do we need to buy more licenses? So it can be a little bit kind of confusing as to, you know, when do I need to buy a license for this product? Or, you know, as I said, in some cases, people will think, like, oh, we don't need to buy any license for that. And, you know, we already have licenses for it. So I know there's like what Microsoft call a seeding of Power Automate within licenses that you would already have. And I suppose some people would describe it as being like you get access to a free Power Automate license, which to a certain degree you do, but at the same time you're paying for that license that it comes seeded with. So Niamh, like what are the different types of scenarios where you see Power Automate being seeded within another Microsoft technology?
Yeah, Carl, I kind of like to call it sort of license included. So there's probably four kind of key Microsoft, you know, licenses which grant you a certain amount, you know, or limited kind of Power Automate use rights. So I'll take kind of the first two, which are kind of application based. So you've got your Power Apps in itself, right? In which, you know, you are granted kind of a limited amount of Power Automate, where and basically what that means is that you get Power Automate within the app context, you know, of the Power App that's been created. So you do get like rights to use standard connectors, the Microsoft connectors, and some premium and custom connectors. Also like the business process flows and any kind of, you know, on-prem gateways. But again, it's all within kind of the Power App itself, the app context. And it's probably good to call out that there's no rights to robotic process automation and an AI builder. Also, so again, you know, Dynamics 365. So you within the context of the Dynamics 365 app, similar to the Power Apps, like you get the rights to use the standard premium, some custom connectors, your business process flows and on-prem gateways. And again, no rights to use robotic process automation and artificial intelligence builder, AI builder. So they're kind of the two apps, right? That are, they're obviously they're Microsoft apps, and that in which you have limited use rights. And then the next two are purely kind of from a personal productivity point of view, right? So you and I have like Microsoft or Office 365 licenses. And so, you know, we're able to use a certain limited, you know, amount of Power Automate in a personal productivity scenario. And I think a common one was, you know, where you can automate saving email attachments to your OneDrive, for example. So in that context, like, you only have access to the Microsoft AKA, the standard connectors, right, in that instance. So you've no rights to any premium or custom connectors, apart from maybe Dataverse for Teams. But again, that's all within, you know, the Microsoft or the Office 365. And obviously excluded from that would be AI Builder, robotic process automation, business flows, on-prem gateways. And then I thought, like, an interesting one as well is the rights to use a limited, you know, to limited Power Automate within Windows 10 Pro or a Windows E3 or E5 license, where, you know, if you wanted to kind of automate some data entry for in conjunction with some legacy applications which have no API. Then, you know, you do have the option, you do have the ability to create like some attended desktop flows, but you've no access to any cloud flows like you would with, obviously, any of the other kind of plans, etc. So it is, it's quite interesting that, like, from, you know, there's probably a lot like that organizations could do, you know, within the context of Dynamics 365 itself, and also with, you know, Power Apps all within kind of the app itself. But once you start kind of getting outside of, you know, kind of within the app, and obviously from anything that you've done on a personal productivity point of view, like, you can't share that, you know, then you're starting to get into the realms of, you know, looking at licensing outside of what's included in the rights that you have with the licenses you have already.
Okay. So I think if there's a couple of things that jumped out of that for me was, you know, you know, using it within the context of the app that it comes bundled with or is seeded with, is a key thing to keep in mind when trying to figure out, you know, when is that license included. And then there was another number of items that you pulled out there, you know, where there's a requirement for premium connectors, business process flows. I think you might have mentioned custom connectors, and I know on-premise gateways as well. That then starts to kind of be the tipping point where you have those requirements to look at some form of a paid, or if you want to call it a standalone Power Automate license plan. So
if it goes outside the context of, you know, the Dynamics 365 application into some other kind of business process flow, or integrating with other kind of data sources, then absolutely, then you start to kind of like put the question mark and start to look at like the standalone Power Automate plans.
Okay, so then I suppose when you look at the paid plans, there's kind of two ways of viewing this, and I think this is, you know, linking it back to Microsoft's product terms. Microsoft view paid plans in two ways. One is, you know, is there a requirement for personal automation or enterprise process automation? So, you know, if we look at it in the most simple terms, personal automation is where you'll probably see a lot of customers starting off. And this is where an individual is looking to use flows to automate a process that might sit within their own desktop PC.
Exactly.
And it's usually used within the context of that individual person. Now, there is an opportunity for those individuals to share those flows with other users, which can in turn create an additional licensing overhead for those users that can run that that flow that has been shared with them. And so when we talk about personal automation, then the best way of licensing that, when we're looking at the various different paid plans, should I say, for Power Automate, is through the use of a Power Automate per user plan. So quite simple, you know, license on a per user basis. And then it's, you know, I've used the phrase a lot in the world of licensing, it's a bit of an all-you-can-eat buffet then. That user can have as many flows, but again, it's dedicated to that specific user.
Right.
One other interesting one then is robotic process automation. I know you've done quite a lot of licensing work in this area, but if there's a need to run attended RPA bots on their workstations, there's a step-up license then required, or a separate license. So you have the option to purchase the Power Automate per user with an RPA component included in there, which is an additional licensing cost versus just a traditional Power Automate per user plan. So that's on the kind of the personal automation side. Then if you kind of want to step it up a gear, right? So not everybody's going to be working in a silo, building automated workflows that sit on their own PC. And what we, you know, what we typically see, you know, as the use of Power Automate grows, or, you know, organizations from the get-go will look to have some form of kind of company-wide workflows that they will run on a scheduled basis. And, you know, these workflows will impact like a large volume of users within their estate. So, you know, when it comes to licensing those types of scenarios, licensing on a per user basis is just not economical, right? So if you think about a, you know, an application that might run on a daily basis, or a flow that might run on a daily basis across a large organization with 10 or 15,000 users, buying a per user license for that those types of scenarios just doesn't make financial sense. So the alternative then is that you can look to license on a per flow basis. And with the per flow basis, it's a little bit like a licensing all you can eat buffet, except this time, instead of having all the flows that you could having an unlimited number of flows that you can run, with this, your licensing, it basically covers all of the users to use that specific flow. So you mitigate the need to have individual user-based licenses. I think if you do kind of some very simple breakpoint analysis on this, where you have scenarios of, like, if you have over, say, 6 users, it starts to make economical sense to look at a per flow license as opposed to a per user license. There's a couple of things actually that I like about per flow is that, you know, it kind of removes a lot of the administration and perhaps some of the licensing headaches that you would associate with per user licenses, trying to police that. Whereas per flow is a lot more cleaner. As I said, it's an all you can eat per user buffet, which, you know, makes a little bit life a little bit easier from a license management perspective. But one thing, you know, is that some organizations might end up having is a scenario where you have, you know, you've bought some per user licenses, then you've bought some per flow licenses. So, you know, it's really important to understand is that if you have that kind of mixed environment, which makes perfect sense in certain scenarios, but you might have found over time that the number of per flow user licenses that you have could actually be cannibalized through the use of per flow licenses. So, you know, have a good look at your estate to see, is there an opportunity to pare back some of those per user licenses that might have grown over time and replace them with a per flow license. There is a third option, which I won't go into too much detail on today's fireside chat, as just a limited introduction to licensing. We'll include some additional information on this in the associated blog. But Microsoft last year, I think it was, they introduced a Power Automate pay-as-you-go licensing model. So in effect, as the name suggests, you pay only for the flows that you use. So that could be quite useful for some organizations that run flows just on a periodic basis. But, you know, there's probably some clever accounting to be done to see, does that make
Definitely.
economical sense? Because from what I've seen, it looks a little bit expensive if, you know, if you don't have that specific need. So worth having a, you know, a closer look at that before jumping in, because per flow licensing at a very high level looks to be a lot more economical than the pay-as-you-go licensing option. But that may differ from organization to organization. So Niamh, like, from your side, can you think of any gotchas, things, additional things to consider around Power Automate from a licensing standpoint, or anything that
I guess one
keeps you up at night on Power Automate?
I guess one of the things to kind of look at, and if you are kind of querying, you know, are you kind of within the use rights of the Power Automate use rights included with like your Dynamics 365 or your Power Apps, etc. And I do like this kind of, well, if the corresponding like apps were deleted, you know, and the flow is also deleted fully, then your flow kind of is in context, as in like, you know, you're within your Power Automate use rights. And I guess like, it's probably worth mentioning, And now it's totally a whole other kind of discussion. But, you know, getting into the realms then of unattended RPA, and we've seen customers like with kind of issues around kind of licensing, you know, unattended digital workers and so on. So that's another kind of really interesting area, but it's definitely between, you know, kind of what you get. Microsoft are definitely kind of driving kind of the adoption of Power Automate and Power Platform, kind of from getting it embedded into, you know, what you can use today with your own licenses, as well as like those broader kind of enterprise wide kind of automated business processes and so on.
Yeah, so they're two really good ones. I think there's two kind of come to mind for me in terms of additional licensing consideration. So good old fashioned multiplexing, you know, does that have an impact in terms of if there's access to data that might have a licensing dependency? You know, that always needs to be considered.
It never goes away.
And then the other one I would say is around external users, right? So Power Automate, you know, it hasn't been really designed to expose flows to external parties. So things like, you know, third-party contractors or vendors, suppliers, customers. So my understanding of that this one is that in order to access those flows, you may need to look at Azure Active Directory being made available to guests. So guest access to Azure AD. You know, that may kick off a licensing dependency there, although the thresholds in terms of what you get out of the box with Azure B2B accesses, you know, there's quite a bit of licensing bandwidth there before you actually start to get charged. However, you know, depending on the scale and size of the organization, that might not necessarily always be the case. And then the other thing to think about is that, you know, when you start to bring in those guest users or third parties into the organization to run flows, they will be in effect treated like an internal user.
Yeah.
And the, you know, byproduct of that is then we've got to have the same conversation around how are those users going to be licensed? Is it, you know, more than likely in the scale, like something of that nature, you probably have it on a per flow basis. But having said that, you know, there is a licensing dependency there for those users, whether it's per app, or sorry, per user, or on a per flow basis. So a couple of things to think about on that one. So I think that about wraps it up for this brief introduction to Power Automate. There's an associated blog that we'll publish off the back of today's fireside chat that will get into some of the items that we discussed in a little bit more detail. Watch out for some of the other videos we've done on within this series on within the Power Platform. There's some useful insights on not just Power Automate today, but the concepts and ideas around tracking Power apps usage. We've done a good video on an introduction to Power apps licensing, some insights on Dataverse, amongst some other videos. So well worth having a look back on this one. So if you have any questions off the back of today's session, don't hesitate to contact us. And until the next fireside chat, we shall see you then. Take care.